comes in via helicopter, comes through these doors over here to my right. And if they're contaminated casualties, we bring them back to one of these three stations right back here, which is our decontamination area. We have a washdown system in there, and we can take care of any treatment that we need to. We can render immediate first aid. And from here, we go down to casualty receiving. So why don't you come on with me? We're going to get in the elevator right here. And we're going to go down to the 2 level. We're up on the 03 level right now, so we're going to be going down four levels. This is casualty receiving right here. Okay, here we are.
Triage area, and this is where the doctors determine which bay the patient will go to. We have four classifications. Up in bay one, we have our expectant and their patients, which are sadly near death, or it would take more than what we have here to save their lives. But they do have the opportunity to get better and be moved up to what we call immediate. And that's where the patients go immediately into surgery or as soon as they have an opportunity to get them into an OR. The next level is minimal, and they're patients with minimal injuries, broken bones, something that they can mend and get them back stateside, or maybe we could help them out and send them back out into the field if they need them. And we also have delayed, and they're patients which need to go to the OR, but it's not an emergency. Okay, this is bay 5. This is one of the immediate bays. Here in bay 5, this is the basic things you would need as soon as the patient might come in. Maybe the 14 to 16 gauge angiocat, 36 French chest tube, size 7.5 to 8 ET tube. And the main thing we think of here are the ABCs, airway breathing and circulation. And we have a go-by sheet here in case someone has a loses their train of thought. Okay. We have the DSM-2 monitor. And this monitor, and you can get blood pressure, you can get the heart rate, and you can run an EKG on this monitor. And the primary thing we want to do when the patient come in is get an ID band on them and make sure they're breathing okay. And then you want to hook up the electrodes to the patient to monitor his heart. Here we have the cart we use. And some of the essentials we'll have here are the IV fluids. Okay, and we have tapes to tape down the IV. We have blood tubes and just about anything you'll need for a patient will be in this cart. Okay. So if you just need something such as a floor drain or a floor vac, we have those over in our Quay area. And Quay is Q-A-I, and that stands for quick access area. And they're just the cabinets here. And just about anything there aren't in the carts you'll find here in some of the different ways. Here we have floor bags, which we hook up to chest tubes. Okay. Here we also have our chits in case You need a special lab result from the lab. You have hematology chip, urinalysis, miscellaneous, and numerous other chips we might use here. Okay, here we keep all of our meds. This is still in the same quay area. We have extra meds. We also have meds in the back where pharmacy works. And here, during the mass casualty situation, which we might have had, and also during the drills, we have people, they wear different color hats. And that's how you identify the people here. And as you can see, the medical officer or triage officer would be wearing the red hats. And they're the ones that decide which way the patient will go in. The admin personnel will wear the green hats, and they log the patient in and make sure they can get them into the OR and get them into a ward. Okay, the CP techs and the respiratory techs, they wear the yellow covers or hats, and they basically work on ventilators and help maintain airway. Okay, and the runners and the litter carriers, they wear the blue covers, and the pharmacists, they wear white hats, and the team leader RN, which is another CAS rec staff nurse, wears the purple hat. Here at CAS rec, we have 34 people on staff right now, which consists of 30 corpsmen and 13 nurses. Okay, and if we had the mass casualty situation, we would use our personnel and augment other personnel to come help us out. And basically, that's it, CAS rec.
Operating room or to ICU, which is through these doors right here. And next we'll bring you to the operating room. Operating room, let's go inside and we'll take a tour of the OR.
This is Petty Officer Hofselecker right here. He's going to give us a tour of the OR.
This is the main operating complex. Over here on the right, we have our nightly 7:30 entertainer. Somebody in the rooms. Back in the surgical suites. It's just 12 rooms with one OR bed in each of them right now. We have a building expanding to two beds in each, 24 surgical cases simultaneously. Come over here on my left, I'll show you which one is.
As far as it goes, on the water, it's a state-of-the-art surgical suite. As far as I know, it's the most advanced in the world at this point. We have hydraulic OR beds, anesthesia equipment with a field anesthesia monitoring unit, overhead surgical lights, x-ray view and box capabilities. We have inline oxygen that you can get from the wall, or we have it from the canisters in case that the inline unit should have to go down. We have the canistered nitrogen tanks to run our power equipment also. Cardiac defibrillators in every room. And after that, we have inline suction also, as well as the oxygen. And if that should happen to break down, we also have the electrical powered suction units back here. We have warming blankets on the bed. All you can see right now is the cables. That's to help ensure to keep patients' body temperature to avoid hypothermia. Each room has a Merlin phone system for in-room usage to go throughout the ship. It connects to the laboratories, casual receiving, and the ICUs so that there's a constant information flow on each patient.
Okay, we're going to be walking down this hallway to ICU, but on the way, let's stop and see what different departments are along here. Come on down here.
Come on out.
This is the other entrance into the operating room on the side here. This is our any service member mail that we have. We get a lot of mail from people back in the States that are showing their support for us. And as you can see, it's identified by each box. Each box has a state, and you can go and find mail from people from your own home state and write them letters. We've also received a lot of posters from different people showing their support for us. And we post those on various parts of the ship. We'll show those to you in other places on the ship.
Let's continue on down the hallway. Right here we have the chaplain's office.
Hey.
Hello.
Turn the light on so you can see us.
These are two of our chaplains.
Hi, everybody.
Greetings, folks.
Chaplain James and Chaplain Webb.
Hey, remembers our names.
I like that.
Well, okay. See you now. See you home soon. See you at the homecoming party.
That's right.
Right. Good. Okay, let's go on. Keep going down the hall.
It wouldn't make me any difference.
These are ramps that go to various portions of the ship. We'll show you some ramps later on in the presentation. This is a stair tower that goes down to different wards, and we'll be visiting those wards also later on in the presentation. Okay, we'll keep going down the hallway here.
At the store? Or
yeah, next door.
This is the aft station area here. This is where people wait that are leaving the ship. As you can see, he's happy because he's getting ready to get out of here. There's elevators around the corner here that go up to the flight deck, and that's how these people get out of here. This is our physical therapy department here. And they can take care of all the problems that any stateside facility would be able to handle. And finally, we've reached the ICU department. There's four ICUs down here. This is ICU number one. And we'll take you through one ICU. They all look the same. This one happens to be a burn ICU, and each one handles a different type of situation. So we'll go on into the ward.
Surgical ICU. There are four ICUs here for a total of 80 beds. Each unit has 20 beds. Also included are PACU, which is recovery room, which has 20 beds. So altogether, we have 100 intensive care beds. This is a medical surgical ICU. It's one of the first ones ever set up like this on a hospital ship. Here we have a crash cart with a physio control life pack, 7 monitor, has the usual drugs and intubation equipment for flow. The Sears Craftsman cart has the sterile supplies for doing a cryotherapy, putting in a chest tube, suturing any of the emergency procedures you need to use. These are monitors connected to a central monitoring station. Each bed is fully monitored. Also, we have the capacity for doing blood pressure monitoring. We also have back in the back here, and on the walls, oxygen tanks as a backup to our piped in oxygen and suction delivery system. We use IVAC 590 monitor volumetric pumps for delivery of hemodynamic fluids, particularly. As you know, in trauma, you use a lot of IV fluids, and they would run wide open, and you wouldn't need any of this type of equipment. We use green sheets because the blood stains white sheets. These are Striker gurneys, which can be mobile. We can take the patient on these to the OR, bring them back, recover them, take them to the ward without moving them from their beds. We also have regular Striker frames. In the back also, we have a dialysis machine. We have three dialysis machines. We have a dialysis tech who works in RT, CT, CT. We also have bare ventilators, bare tube. And as a backup, we have the old IPPD PR2 Bennett machines. We have the capacity for taking care of a patient who's ventilated, getting dialysis, getting IV fluids, on a cardiac monitor, and pretty much it's sophisticated medicine. We've been called the finest trauma center afloat. We are the largest hospital in the world. Thank you. Come again to this ward.
Okay, now that we saw the ICU ward, we're going to be heading down to the hallway, down to one of the regular wards. That's where the patients go after they've recovered in ICU. So let's go down the stair tower over here.
Okay. Welcome to 5TAC 71. Step right this way and we'll introduce you to our company. This is the nurse's station. These are our jobs. They're all essential. This is a 5TAC 71 case code. The lieutenant calls in turn and introduces two of our staff members. What else do we have? Don't you walk this way, huh? Just around the room. Here's our wonderful bed. You should have some of the beds now. Ready to go. The only hospital in town with bunk beds. So that's what we're doing. Here's all of our equipment. The essential feature of every hospital ship, EBDs for everybody. Our family wall. Let's see, what else can we do? Here's our supply area.
Oh, hi.
This, oh, look at this, another staff member behind us. We're recording
what they do all day.
We're recording the food in here.
This is the most essential part of our unit.
Yes, really.
We have grazing table.
The grazing cabinet.
The food.
The coffee pot and the food.
The cookies. Coleman's Lifeline coffee.
The other side, you can see our other 72 beds of unoccupied space. Here's our wonderful educational aid.
In a whole room like this, now it's bunched up right now, it's the way you should pull it out of the box.
This is the annex to the education department. We have 72 beds on this side, 68 beds on this side. We do ambulatory care, and that's all we have to show you.
Our mailbox.
Oh, yeah.
Our mailbox.
That's our best part of our unit. We can see our life jacket. Get it close up to that.
I don't know why. Our other unusual our do-it-yourself chocolate. No award would be complete without that. And the case of the sky. Our life jacket closet. One for everybody. And that's about it. Oh, let's see. Let's go back into our kitchen. Here's our big kitchen, complete with microwaves and running water. Soda. Our other favorite part of the day, our soda locker. And our utility equipment room. Step right this way. And that's the highlight for 5-10-71. Oh, one more thing. Our excellent bulletin board, our patient status board, our schedule that we never used. Those are the high, oh, here we go, our comfort, our PODs and our comfort clips. What more could a Navy hospital want? And that's it.
This is the x-ray department. They've got the processors here and the film bin. And they got, oh, they got a CT scan up on here. Looks just about the same as it does at home. Their angio room is right here, right?
Yeah.
Right here. All the rooms are basically the same, like one has a Franklin head unit and one has a tomography. This is where the fast film changer is. I guess this is it. I guess this is the Schoenander type thing. And they have a few guide wires and catheters and stuff like that on the wall. Not to the extent we have at home. But basically all the rooms look like this. They've got 5 x-ray rooms and a CT scan. So, and I think they have about 4 portables. So they have a pretty good setup. Okay, and we're gonna go right out this door and we'll go right out to Cas Rec. Because as the patients are coming through, that we're on the way through the system here.
He said, daylight come and be warm.
Thank you. Thank you.
kept it going till the sun fell down.
Thank you. saying the street was bad. Your roots.
And no,
without a doubt.
No beer.
Doorway to the left. We have signs that tell us where we're
early, and he's going to give you a tour of the lab.
This is our chemistry section. This is mainly where we do all of our chemistry work as far as electrolytes, liver functions, and that type of thing. And over here, one half of our hematology section, we do we have four machines used to do complete CBCs, two cultures, and right behind us on the other side there. Before we read all our differentials, we have one scope, but then right now we don't have a lot to do anyway. So we just said our centipede is going to bring down this pressure. Now over here, part two of our hematology department, these two instruments are shut down right now, but they all set the blood clots. And this is our coagulation department. We do our coag. We have two engines and they're a little bit ancient, but they do a pretty good job. They get the job done. They serve a purpose. And right over here, again. There's more, I guess this is a brand new instrument. We just got it in maybe a week ago. It's all up and ready to go. This is what we do everything as far as therapeutic drug testing. We haven't had a chance to do any patients on it yet, but she's up and ready to go in case of moving. And back to my brother, Bob. I have an administrative computer there. Oh, wait a minute, let's stop here for a second. I forgot about serology. This is what we do. RPR, basic RPR, and real pregnancy test. So this is the serology section. It falls under microbiology. Golden marker here.
Amount of medication we need a large supply. Okay. Okay, over here are some pellets with more bulk meds. Our compounding room. This is where we do a lot of our conversing and training and compounding.
is our wood carvings.
Prescriptions from the window. Put them in the computer and fill them right here and then dispense them back out. This is mainly for outpatients, again. Walk-in refrigerator. My biggest refrigerator besides the galley on the boat. Lots of beds. Okay, and then in here, this is where we make up all of our IVs. IV room, one of our hottest rooms in the pharmacy. It's continually warm in here. This is called laminar flow hood. This is where we have to stand in to make the IVs in a more clean, sterile environment.
Continue our tour in CSR, where they sterilize all their equipment for medical. Here's Agent Dowdy. He'll show you around and explain it.
Okay, this is CSR. And CSR is a place where we sterilize, decontaminate surgical instruments. Comes up in the ward or 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 anywhere like that. You first go to the decontamination area and I'll run you through the process.
Oh,
this is the crew right here.
How
you
doing?
How you doing?
Peace in the Middle East.
Peace. That's what we've got on the board over here. No more war.
Quest for peace in the Middle East. Yeah, let's go home.
That's right.
Raise the law.
You can go back there.
Oh, okay.
Hey, look over here, try a racket ball.
Okay. This is our decontamination area. And first of all, surgery will bring up on a dumbwaiter there, like your surgical instruments or something like that. We'll pull them off. And rather it being a scope or surgical instruments or anything like that, we decontaminate it. And Cydex, there's a Cydex pan over there for scopes and such like that. We have three washer sterilizers, and that's for surgical instruments.
SHTV Medical, 7230.
Anything like that. They're loaded up on this side after wiping
MS1
down,
Lloyd,
wiping down or decontaminating the instruments or anything.
MS1 Lloyd, 7359.
And once the cycle has completed, this door will go down on the other side. You'll see that when we get to the other side, it comes down. But this, like I said, is decontamination or everything that has to do with decontaminating surgical instruments or scopes or anything else like that. That's the back of the steam sterilizers. We'll get to those. We've got some bandages and supplies in the cabinets.
I've forgotten everything.
We keep basically a lot of stuff up here, anywhere from like our surgical instruments to our bandages, from our cleaning solutions to sterile gear or anything like that.
Huh?
We'll make it a unit.
I'm sorry.
What's wrong?
Girl. Nice to cover, Steve.
No. This is sterile side right here. Once you get past that line right there, this is a sterile environment. Usually shoe covers and a pair of scrubs. Like I said, this is a washer sterilizer. The instruments come down on this side right here. As you can see, we got some ready for work tomorrow. This is where we process a lot of our instruments. They come out of the washer just like this, just ready to go. We make sure all the pieces are here. We wrap it with wrap, just like it's over here on the cart. We log it in our book. After we log it, it goes into the sterilizers. These are our steam sterilizers. And once they get sterilized, after about an hour or so, they come out. After they come out, let them cool off, and we put them in the cabinets. These are the cabinets for all the sterile gear in it. Anywhere from GYN to ENT to ortho and such like that. And basically that's all CSR is all about, decontaminating and sterilizing.
Now we're going to continue down the hallway here. Here's banners they put up. Different states will send different banners for different occasions.
This is nothing beat the Texan. They all come.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, bro. Down here, there's right here at stairwells down to the birthing. And then after this, there's doors leading to the outside deck of the ship. The other side looks the same. Right here is where they bring in supplies and load them up, and they also have jazzercise here and different type of exercises. Here's the MAA office.
Add them up! I'm gonna walk with
you. Here's the list too. When anybody else sees bring anything, you leave the list here and the paper here. Everybody on the
restaurant. What are you looking for in here?
I have to call her. His girlfriend first.
Call his girlfriend? She's what?
Okay.
Girlfriend,
we're
coming back.
Jazzercise. That's another recreation we have. It's like an aerobic exercise they do. It keeps the rail off. Right here's our office.
whole hallway is full of supplies. Right over here is the bench prep area.
serve breakfast, we serve lunch, dinner, and then we have what's called mid-rats, which is for the night crew that works, and it's served from 11:15 to 12:15 at night. You have the grills where they cook the eggs, do potatoes, all the fried things that they need to get done for breakfast and lunch, and do hamburgers and stuff like that. Here is where we serve at, and these are filled with water, and then the pans are laid on top of them to keep them warm. And anything can go in here, from pancakes to syrup. All the food that we serve goes through there. These are little freezers. Right now somebody's got some cream in there, but they usually store the syrup and stuff at night. Here's one of the big walk-in fridges. Right now they're storing the milk. They usually have pies in there for the, well, in fact, they do right over there. For the, And that's about it for the tour of the galley. I hope I covered everything. Now I think we're going to proceed to the mess decks. Left the galley. I'm going to show you the serving lines and the mess decks where we eat. Where they go out and eat their food. Right now, here's the serving line. We serve more than 3,600 people a day. Right here, as you can see, is where everybody goes down and picks up their trays and their knives, forks, silverware, waits the line. In the morning, they ask for eggs, and they serve their eggs up, special orders and such. They have their bacon and regular sorts of food, and we have three servers and one mess cook, which is a regular in mess, who helps them serve and sort of watches over them to make sure nothing is done wrong. To the EMS crew to
petty stuff, such as mopping the floors, the deck, and setting the stuff out on the table. And over here is one of the microwaves we have. I think we have two or three in the galley. A lot of people usually put popcorn in at night. That's a good thing to do while they're sitting around watching TV in the lounge.
Back.
we can buy our cigarettes, our soda, candy bars, potato chips, all the stuff that's good for us. Gymnasium. We're going to go inside and take a look at that and scan around a little bit. This is H.M. Bellard.
Hi.
He's going to give us a little tour of the library.
Okay.
How are you guys doing today?
Good.
Okay, this is where all the videos come from. Everybody for entertainment and whatnot. One of the big entertainment is videos. And here in the video, in the library, we have a video section with pretty up-to-date videos here. We have our medical section here. This is where all the medical books are, okay? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 stacks of medical books, so definitely is a medical ship, yeah, that's for sure. Over here we have our just basic reading books, all sorts of different kinds to suit everybody's opinion and needs and whatnot, whatever. Same thing here, books, donated from all sorts of people. Here is all our fiction section. These are located in alphabetical order and whatnot. And we have, as you can see, we have plenty of these as well. And that's about it. And we're a facility of the chaplains. The chaplains run the library here. That's about all.
Okay, right now we're on the 03 level. Three level, and we have the post office, the chapel, the officer's lounge, and the laundry room back here, so we'll show you those. This is the post office right here. They handle all the outgoing mail, incoming mail. They probably work harder on their ship than most people. They have to stamp all of our letters that are going out that are free, and they handle all the packages that are going in and out of here, and they weigh everything for us, everything that a normal post office would do. Right down the hallway here, we have the chapel. This is a chapel. They offer various types of church services here. They offer Catholic Mass 7 days a week, and they offer various Protestant services. Okay, now let's go to the other end down here and we'll show you the barbershop and the laundry room. This is the barbershop right here. You can see the sign up here. That's where we get our haircuts. The haircuts are done for free. You can come in there as many times as you want. And right back back here, we have the laundry room. The ship does our laundry for us, but we have delicate clothes, or if you have something that you want to wash yourself, we have washers back here that are available. These are also free for our use.
Instrument panel right here, which controls the ship, and then we have the two radars on the starboard and port side. And we got the helm right here. This is where we steer the ship, and our rudder angle, left, right, rudder. Course by gyro. The backup is magnetic. And here is where they plot the courses. Every day they blow the general alarm and the horn.
60 seconds to go.
Get everybody tied up. Fix their watches.
And over here we have a our RPM RPM gauges and our standby it tells you which direction. Which direction the ship is going in engine wise. Aircraft radar right here. This is our computerized radar. And we also have the wind direction nautometer. Tell us how fast the wind's going and which direction's coming out of. And the captain's chair right here. He sits right here. Oversees the wheelhouse. And this is the third mate right here.
I will.
Busy work. Official business.
That's Sean. He's on standby right now. That's about it.
Lieutenant J.G. Stoll, one of the nurses in the burn unit here on Comfort. And the guys asked me to talk a little bit about some of the weather and stuff we're having out here right now. Today is supposed to be a sunny day. You can see the sun trying to come down through here, but what you're seeing out here in this haze, what would normally look like a dirty fog, is actually some of the ecological damage resulting from the Iraqis' intentional bombing and explosion areas of the Kuwaiti oil fields. As right now reported, there's almost, they had like a total of 900 and some odd change of the oil wells, and almost all of those are on fire. You can look, you can see it's all gray here right now. The northern direction is over this way, and if you look, you can see a slight line of demarcation here, which should be actually sunny. When we first got here a few months ago, we weren't quite this far up, but you can see where it should be a sunny and a clear day. Of Ras Al Khafji, which is about 15 miles below the Saudi-Kuwaiti border right now. The wind's blowing in this southerly direction right now, and so we're catching a full brunt of what has happened. How long it's going to take to clear this up, only knows, but it's a severe damage, and it's even cold out here right now. It feels like about 50, 60 degrees out here. Normally you might get a good 75, 80 degree weather at this time of the year. So it's caused a lot of damage, and you can look down by the anchor chain later on this, and you can see oil around the anchor and the sides of the ship too. So these people have caused a lot of damage, and ecologically how long it's going to take to clear up, we don't know, but people feel like it's going to be one of the severest things in the history of the world. This is where the helicopters actually land. They can fit two helicopters on there at a time if they have to. They like to only land one at a time, but they can fit two on there. And if you notice in the background, there's a bunch of people gathering, and what they're doing, they're listening to the news. At the top of every hour, people gather out here to listen to shortwave radio on the British Broadcasting Network. The side of the flight deck over here, there's some safety nets. That's in case anybody happens to fall off the flight deck. Catch now. Normally there's a lot of people that jog out here, but due to the air pollution right now, the smoke from the oil wells, there aren't very many people that dare come out here and jog. So, okay, next we're going to be going over and looking at the life rafts. So, why don't you follow me down the stairs?
All hands on smoke, stand clear for frame 72. Smoking lanterns out on all weather decks. All hands remind to remove covers. Flight quarters, all designated personnel, man your flight quarters stations. All hands on ball, stand clear for order frame 72. Smoking lanterns out on all weather decks, all hands reminded to remove covers. Purpose of flight quarters for receipt of EVO from Bahrain International Airport to pick up outgoing passengers to Bahrain. No mail inbound. Now flight quarters.
up on the upper level of the ship, and we're standing over the lifeboats over here. And we have 10 of these lifeboats. These are designed to take the patients off in case we had to abandon ship. Each boat is designed to hold between 100 and 125 patients. And those cars that you see on the boats, they open up, and the stretchers land those bars as they open up. Each boat has a doctor and a nurse and corpsman assigned to it to care for the patients in case there's any emergencies or if they need any medical treatment while they're out in the boat. Back behind me is Steel Beach. Today's Sunday. Normally we can come out here and lay out in the sun on Sunday, but again, due to the pollution outside, that we can't come out here. And if I can have the photography zoom in on the deck down here, you can see what the smoke has done. There's soot everywhere, all over the ship. They wash down the ship every day, but it doesn't help. The Red Cross down here has a special paint, and that's designed to be picked up by radar, and it identifies us as a hospital ship. Okay. And if you can zoom in on the water down there, you can notice that there's oil all over the water. You can notice the slicks. And back behind us is our escort ship. That's a Canadian frigate. And that's protecting us from any incoming hostile action. Okay, next we're going to go down and look at the individual life rafts.
I'm out here on the 01 weather deck, right next to the life raft. We have to get in case there's an abandoned ship. And we have abandoned ship drills and everything. The knees get lowered down into the water by these davits right here. And you just work up and they attach to them. And they automatically inflate right next to the ship. And this large cable here lowers them down, and they hold 25 people, capacity of 25, and there's food and everything you need for survival. They say if we ever did have an abandoned ship, this ship wouldn't sink anyways because it's so shallow. About his job.
As he said, I'm H.N. Havely. I'm of the elite group, as you know, the master at arms. Our basic job is to maintain the security of the ship. We basically look around and see. Right now, as you can tell, the weather is quite bad because Kuwait, you know, that's from the oil wells burning. You know, my job is to look around and make sure ain't no mines coming up to the ship. Blow up the ship. I basically maintain, keep law and order within the ship as well as outside of the ship. Now, as you know, we have like a fantail watch. We have like a forecastle watch. We have watches on the port and the starboard. And basically on the people on the 03 to 04 level, the flight deck and the bridge. when the bombing had first started with Iraq, when we moved closer to north, we had to make sure that the people was not up on the weather decks as well as the fantail and stuff after dark due to the possible of a chemical attack. I mean, so basically, when we're looking out for the mines, we're basically protecting the ship as a whole. You know, we don't want to endanger anybody's lives. We'd rather put our lives in danger before we put someone else's lives in danger.
Okay, hello, I'm HN Pasquale. We're gonna take a trip down to the berthing. Ready?
Follow me.
We're on the 01 level right now. Upstairs is the galley. That's the
That's right, you got it right.
The elite Navy medical field. And right below, in the 03 level, is the female officer's berthing, which needs an escort required every time you go in there. And here's a female now.
Oops. Hello.
You follow me. We're at the end of our tour, which is the enlisted male berthing. Right this way. The enlisted male berthing. Okay, right here is the bathroom. So I have to keep the doors closed because of the smell sometimes emitting from the drain pipes. Sometimes you have some kind of fecal matter that stays inside the toilet. These are the heads, toilets for civilians. Over there's the additional sinks and a nape. Okay, right this way. Station right there, separating the berthing. Here's an additional extra head right there. Fire escape and the baggage storeroom right there. Okay. This is the enlisted berthing with many enlisted, at least 126 beds. There goes some enlisted right there. Just smoking around doing the enlisted thing.
Going home!
Right this way is more enlisted birthing people. As you can see, it's quaint.
At least 90 minutes of continuous walking day.
This is referred to as the ghetto.
Who's this for? Who does that for?
Who? And who? And who's this for? And who take recording? Who's that for? Your mom? And right, who my shit?
Okay, these are our lockers and our racks. As you can see, they are
3 high, and our breathing is below the waterline. We have makeshift curtains here, and if there's any kind of fire or emergency, we have our oxygen breathing devices, escape, the EEBD. You just pop these open and remove your head, and it gives you 15 minutes of oxygen. Okay. Over here is our wall lockers. We get a bunk locker and a wall locker, and an extra storage locker. As you can see, everybody has at least 2 lockers.
So you ain't got.
Over here is all of our life jackets, if required. Venice the drill. Quick access. Our scuttle butt, our birthing phone, and our laundry. This is where we dump all our laundry. Okay. I guess we should head into the lounge. I'll show you the lounge now. Afternoon, fellas. I cut out.
Yeah.
And this time.
Okay, we're heading back past the heads here. Man working out.
Oh, by the way, it's the 3rd of February.
It's, March.
March.
Oh, it is. Okay, so it's March. Lost track of time.
Here's the, writing room. People writing and doing a lot of things.
Hello. Oh.
Pretty big writing room. We should have a TV room this year. And here is the TV room. VCR and TV with people watching it. Every day we watch TV.
You know me and Nito, huh? I put enough in there to bring the engine card.
Jeff, the telephone. Get the phone.
Okay.
Jeff, I'm back on the phone.
That's about it of our birthday. This has been H.M. Pasquale live from the USNS Comfort, and I'd like to say goodbye. For the admin department.
Okay, now we're going to go into the lens lab. They're the ones that make the good-looking glasses that I'm wearing here. Aren't these good? They're good for dates, and if you want to go out and meet new people, they're really good for that. This is Petty Officer Sharon right here. He's going to give us a tour of the lens lab.
Peace. Alright, this is the eye clinic here. That's our first patient right there.
We make these flashy eyewear that the narrator here is wearing. Tape's optional. Here we can do a full eye exam. We have two ophthalmologists and one optometrist. So we can do full eye exams and complete cataract, retina surgery. Also make glasses. The lab is right back this way. That's Greg right there.
How
he's
doing?
One of the opticians back here in the lab.
I'm the best optician back here in the lab.
We have all the convenience at home.
microwave, refrigerator. These are the edges here. We start out with a blank piece of plastic, about yay big. Cuts it down to the small ends, inserted into a frame. Over here is a hand edger wheel to smooth out the lens. After that, snap it in a frame and it's done.
Hey man, what are you looking at?
Just look over here. This is our morale booster right above the phone.
Ridiculous, isn't it?